Hi, I am Tanya Haynes, and I'm pleased to be talking to Tete of the Third World Network Africa today.
Nice to meet you as well.
Today you presented on agriculture and rural development, and you talked about the issue of fragmentation with the farming and non-farming sector, but also different industries that, you know, could coordinate with the small farmers. And I was curious to hear more about your policy proposal to address these fragmentations.
Okay, yes, that's true. My proposal is focused on three key areas, really. The first is that if you take every African economy, like most other economies in the third world, as you rightly said, agriculture is not connected to manufacture is not connected to mining, mining is not connected to services or finance or trade or anything. So the starting point is to generate those interlinkages. So for instance, if you have agricultural products, certain raw materials in manufacturing products, there is a market for agricultural products. The manufacturing sector can also begin to make the inputs, machinery and things that the agricultural sector needs. So that's one area. There's also the possibility of the mining sector, for instance, to provide inputs and skills and labor. So, I mean, one of the problems in rural agriculture, small scale agriculture in many areas, is that there's no irrigation. But a lot of mining companies have pumps that they use to pump water from underground, which they can just make available to villagers to pump water from their river streams into their farms as irrigation projects, for instance. Or they have many, many equipment that they use, that all they have to do is to use rural technology skills. So, for instance, to manufacture balls that are used in crushing minerals. What do you need is local blacksmiths who have got those skills and employ them. So these are some of the interconnections that you have to make.
Again, at the policy level, what are the recommendations that you would make to address the fragmentation?
So basically it means that you have to ensure that the inputs that different sectors use are procured from the economy rather than importing them. So rather than, for instance, importing paint to be used in villages, we know that women can use their skills in shea oil to produce paint. But to do that, you have to have an appropriate trade policy. Because the reason why paint is coming and being used in rural areas is that it has been liberalized, it comes cheap, tax-free, tariff-free. But from economists, because they have got stronger base of production, therefore produce cheaper. So you have to have a trade policy which is protective of the domestic economy to nurture domestic producers, for instance. There's another policy with this that is related to, say, the rural producer themselves and their needs, right? So they have no access to affordable credit, no access to technology, no access to infrastructure, no access to inputs. And it's possible for the public sector to provide affordable credit through different mechanisms, so that people can actually borrow money in ways which addresses both the condition of their production, but also makes it possible for them to actually borrow money and use it sustainably. So there's credit policies in one area, finance policies in another area, infrastructure policies. These are some examples of policies.
And in terms of the credit, finance, and trade policy recommendations that you make, what is specifically feminist about those policies?
You have to take a step back because the way I understand both the feminist and the heterodox framework that we have been using in our paper and our conversations is rooted in two things: the way in which power in this organization or resources is arranged. So that some people have power and have access to resources, others don't have those power and resources. And secondly, how that power and its monopoly is expressed in the imbalance of the economy. Now, if we take, say, the area of the rural economy which women predominantly as producers, but also as consumers, are at the receiving end of power monopoly, then that's in the area which your policies can intervene. So to give two examples, when women go to the credit market to borrow money, when they are given a loan, nobody takes into account that the woman who has got borrowed money to start a farm is going to not only use it for the farm, but actually most of the time it's also using it to feed the children, pay the children's school fees, and things like that. Now, financial institutions, the financial policies don't create a condition where they can think that, look, I'm not simply lending money for as a capital, but also lending money which goes into consumption. So how do I structure my product in such a way that allows the woman to have part of their credit to actually go into investment in the production, but also support and subsidize and sustain her when she has to feed her children, for instance, pay their school fees. It's possible to have different financial products for that, but at the moment we don't go into that. Even the most progressive financial policy simply says, let us target microcredit. But actually, microcredit, precisely because of its character, is much more devastating because you have to pay whether you use the money to feed your children or not. So that's one example. There's another point, technology. So for instance, I mentioned the case of women being predominant in the shea butter industry in, say, Ghana and Burkina Faso. There's tons and tons of technology that can make it easier women to process the shea butter in terms of the labor that we use to process it from shea nut to shea butter. That technology is not being invested in because it's not profitable, because the metric for investing in technology is profitability rather than the social target. Now it's possible to think about technologies that address the labor needs of women in economic areas and invest in them, even if the state has to invest in them at losses. Sometimes you invest in things today, and it's not going to make any profit for the next 10 years. But that's the base on which you can rebuild people's productive capacities for the future. So these are just two examples in which you can say you have, you know, policies which are gender specific in their context of rural production.
And because the structural transformation and the structural changes that are required for rural development require this sensitivity to gender as a structuring inequality in society and to addressing that.
Absolutely, because in fact, those structured inequalities limit not simply the possibilities of women themselves to be good, if you put it that way, to kind of fulfill their material and cultural needs, but it also puts, you know, puts a limit on the resilience of the entire economy, right? So addressing the gender-based discrimination and constraints is also a way of lifting up the conversation of the economy in that sense.
And so do you see any potential with the sustainable development goals for the advancement of the kinds of policies you're proposing? Do the SDGs provide a possibility or a space?
The SDGs are a double-edged sword. They proclaim some goals, they proclaim some challenges, and they proclaim objectives. But below the objectives is how to get there. And how to get there is actually a contestation between two paradigms. You can get there by using the existing ways of thinking, which is the neoliberal market-based ways. In that sense, you just reinforce the inequalities and inequities that you want to.
And sometimes create new inequalities and stratifications.
Or you have to then rethink, think through, apply different ways of thinking, heterodox policies, which makes you to rethink the ways in which society and its relationships are structured. So let us put it this way. The SDGs are an opportunity to have a different struggle about alternative ways of thinking. If we are not able to make sure that the alternative ways of thinking becomes much more dominant than existing ones, then the SDGs will really just take us back to where we were before the SDGs. By themselves, they are not the solution, but they provide the opportunity to struggle in different ways.